Ladies and gentlemen, namaskar. Welcome to the 13th Zee Jaipur Literature Festival in association with Nexa at Charbagh. We request the audience to kindly occupy the front rows first. There are a lot of vacant seats that can be filled up. We are delighted to introduce session 103, Books to Digital. How to translate books on screen? What is the process of adaptation? This session examines and reflects on the scope and potential of converting text to digital platforms. We have with us Sandeep Unnithan, the executive editor of India Today magazine, who also writes on security-related issues. He's recently co-authored Operation X, The Untold Story of India's Covert Naval War. His Black Tornado, The Three Sieges of Mumbai 2611 has been adapted into a Z5 original title, State of Siege 2611. Accompanying him on the panel, we have Sumrit Shahi, a novelist, screenwriter, and a motivational speaker who has written 7 popular youth-based television shows. His book, Never Kiss Your Best Friend, has been recently adapted into a web series. The talented duo would be in conversation with Nalin Mehta, the executive editor of the Times of India Online, an award-winning social scientist, journalist, and author of several interesting books like What Television Tells Us About Modern India, Dreams of a Billion, India, and Olympic Games. Let's welcome the gentlemen with a huge round of applause.
Thanks very much for joining us on a lovely January day. We have with us two very interesting authors, Sandeep and Sumrit, whose work is very diverse. Sandeep works on strategic issues, on defense. Your area of work is very different from the kind of work on relationships that Sumrit, for example, works on. We are at this moment, you know, when I started my work on television and digital, one of the things people always asked was, you know, we have a house of cards in the American market. Why doesn't India create a house of cards equivalent, that kind of programming? And one of the answers that came to that question was that one episode of House of Cards cost $10 million. Now, where is the, do you have that kind of scale to produce programming of that sort? Now, I think at this moment, we are in a golden age, if you like, for storytellers with the profusion of digital platforms. We are at a big inflection point for the last 2 or 3 years since data became so cheap in this country. So let me begin by asking you, Sandeep, to begin with, your work, you're a print journalist. You wrote a book on the Mumbai terror attacks of 2008. That book came out in 2014, and you went through a whole process trying to get it filmed or get film adaptations of it, and that didn't work. But now, suddenly, you've got a web series coming out. So what's changed in the way the entertainment infrastructure around you, around storytelling, has changed?
Thanks very much, Nalin. It's great to be here this afternoon. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. First off, what you asked me about how things have changed, I think there have been two big changes that we have seen in the last couple of years. The first one is GOT, and the second one is OTT. So Game of Thrones and over-the-top platforms. So when I wrote my book in 2014, a friend of mine from the film industry actually approached me. She picked up the book, she read it, and she said, I'd like to option this as a film script, you know, and she started reading through it, and she came back to me a little confused. Now, the book, Black Tornado, is about the three sieges. It's the military aspects of the November 2611 attacks. It actually talks about what went on in the sieges, you know, the mindsets of the people who went in there, the exact attacks and the response as it unfolded. So it's a very never-before kind of told story, if I might call it that, because I got first-person interviews with the commandos who were inside there. So essentially, the story is told through their perspective. Now, my friend from Bollywood, if you can call it that, she says that, look, I can't make head or tail of this book. It has no characters that start and, you know, the book begins with and ends with. It has no one cogent narrative. It's characters. There are so many characters, locations. It's really confusing.
So
I can't
like
make
no
a movie
alpha
out of
characters
it.
Dominating.
Absolutely,
it's a,
yeah.
It's a multitude of a cast of multiple,
yeah,
multiple characters.
And cut to 2017, 2018, after the OTT
so
boom.
Just hang on there for a second. So what you're saying is that this... Now, the Bombay attacks of 2008 were one of the most significant events in the history, yes, of this country. Obviously, anything written on it would incite the interest of those who want to dramatize in various ways. But in the format that Bollywood existed at that point of time, they couldn't find a way of extracting that into a form that they thought would replay to a market.
That's right.
That's essentially what,
yes,
you're saying.
Yes.
So what has changed now? How different has your experience been dealing with the digital platforms?
So what has happened now is that you have OTT platforms who are not constrained by a two-hour narrative or a three-hour narrative. They can play out over 6 hours, 8 hours. You have much more time to go into character building, and you know, which the kind of constraints that you have in a cinema script, you don't have that in an OTT platform, a web series, for instance. So that's exactly what Contillo and Z have done with Black Tornado. It's called State of Siege. And from the looks of it, it's a very, very gripping kind of edge of the seat, Hollywood style thriller.
So Sumrit, you work in a totally different genre. Your last work, How to Kiss Your Best Friend, How Not to Kiss Your Best Friend, has also become a web series with Z5. The question I wanted to ask you is, unlike Sandeep, you also, you work in television. You're a television writer as well. So how different has your experience been when you translated your work from the strictures of a novel and that format into a much larger web series with different, where you could play much more creatively with it?
I think what we need to understand is, I mean, it's common parlance to diss television in this country right now, A, because of the content that comes out, and I'm completely with you on that. But what also one needs to understand is that television still in this country is an involuntary medium. We still are a country of single household television sets, and it's not consumption that you're doing voluntarily. So the creativity has to, you know, they have to look at it in a way where sensibilities have to be taken into account. Unlike the web, which is completely personal viewing. So when you have personal viewing, you automatically can cater to more liberal or more broader ideas, and that really enhances your creativity in that sense. So that's really helped, because in television one has to be very careful of sensibilities at a mass stroke. Because I'll give you an example. I was writing a couple of youth shows. That's how I started. I was writing for Channel V and MTV, and we were told to create feminist characters in, you know, quotes. But when it really comes down to the understanding of the word, they were very broad strokes. Whereas in the web, you can really play around with the character.
But that's also because in television, you're playing to the TRP market, because everything is measured by what the TRP meter says. If it doesn't register on that, doesn't matter how good your content is, it'll get kicked off air after a point of time.
Tell you about it.
The question, you know, coming back to questions of quality and bandwidth, Sandeep, when your work was translated, now, there can be nothing more sensitive than a portrayal of a terrorist attack. In this country, we've had a tradition for a very long time, at least in many, with few honorable exceptions, of a lot of patriotic jingoism, a lot of nationalism-based films, which may not necessarily have the nuance of what actually happens on the ground. A lot of flag waving, chest thumping, but less real, more dramatic. Now, when your work was adapted, how did you deal with questions of that, of accuracy, of nuance, of shades of gray?
Right. So, Nalin, the reason, and as you pointed out, the fact is that India has never really made a true war movie. You know, it's all Bollywood songs and dance movies with some action sequences in it. And, you know, you have like six songs, and you have Border with six songs, you have LOC with, I don't know, 12 songs. So we've never truly made a war film, because we shy away from the real nature of war. I mean, I don't see a 1917 kind of movie ever being made in Bollywood in the near future, because the real nature of war is really scary. But what they have changed in this, and what has really changed, because you're not bound by the necessities of catering to a box office. You have invested 100 crore in it, you need to recover that kind of money, and therefore you have to put in these so-called nationalistic themes and all of that in, and you know. So in this, in an OTT platform, for instance, they have kind of been if you can call it, liberated from that thing of catering to the nationalistic, patriotic fervor kind of thing, you know. So they are able to make the series more accurate, more realistic in a sense.
What I'm interested in particularly, we were talking before we came on stage, with the fact that this kind of creative fusion, if you like, with Hollywood, which is that in the case of your series, they brought in directors, screenwriters from overseas who had experience of doing that kind of realistic storytelling, as opposed to simply creating a miasma of
sure. So the response that I got from the makers was that, look, we are at a very nascent stage when it comes to OTT in India. We don't have the bandwidth, we don't have the talent yet to approach a docudrama kind of thing like a Delhi crime or the spy or something like that. So we really need to get that kind of talent in. And this reminds me of the early days of Indian cinema itself, when you had technicians coming in from abroad because there were certain kinds of action sequences that you didn't have a grip on. But essentially the story is the main thing, right? I mean, we're all here because of the stories that we tell and the characters that we build on. So, I mean, that is one thing that that's really changed in this one, is the fact that you had a very Western sensibility of, telling a counter-terrorist operation as it unfolded, without getting into this nationalistic, patriotic, jingoistic kind of thing.
So, on the craft of storytelling itself, unlike Sandeep, in your work, you wrote the novel and you didn't just hand over the rights of the novel to somebody. You also wrote the screenplay. You also wrote the dialogues for the web series. In terms of portraying the same characters on the mediums, how much changes did you make? And how much changes do you think you had to make for the story to have another life, if you like?
I have I'm 25, I'm not married, but this is the most paternal I've felt, yeah, to see your characters in flesh and blood. It is a crazy feeling altogether. So I was very anal about it. Like, I would have it. I was actually in talks with this on other platform for a while, but they wanted to make some very drastic changes. So I think what I wanted to retain was the core essence of the characters and the journeys that they were taking, and that I retained. You change things cinematically, maybe because it's the visual medium and those necessities you are okay with, but I did not change the core. And personally for me, it was pretty smooth. I think what I was scared of was the reader's response, because when you're reading something, you have a very personal idea visually of, what that character would be like. And an actor always comes in, I mean, that's their job, to come in with their own interpretations. So I just was scared of the marriage that would happen there, but it's not, divorce is not on the anvil, so it's going fine right now.
Sandeep, jumping back to your story, one of the big challenges in portraying a real life event, and bear in mind that unlike the United States, and the US also has films like, series like Rambo and others, it's not just Bollywood that that uses cinema as a form of a certain kind of story, of narrative. The point I'm trying to make is that there is a tradition in the United States of also making films on sensitive, or in other or other liberal democracies, of making critical films on issues of which happen in real life in the lifetimes of the existing protagonists. You think of W, you think of various kinds of films on that. In India, you make a film on any or a TV show on any sensitive political issue, you will have 10 people protesting, you will have people going to court, all of that, the screening being stopped. On something like a terrorist attack in Mumbai, how did you deal and tread that fine line on dealing with these issues? For example, the biggest problem with the narrative around 2008, apart from the horror of the terror attack, was how the media covered the issue of the hostages. And you were there, so you know exactly what happened. So how do you deal with that? I mean, where did you draw the line between being being absolutely true to what happened, or changing things here and there to push the story that you were trying to say?
Nalin, so 2611, the attacks were very unique in the sense that this is the first time that you had a terror attack that was being remote controlled from thousands of kilometers away. So while the terrorists were on the ground, you had the controllers sitting in a control room in Karachi, monitoring them and telling them what to do. And the media that's us. We unwittingly played into this game. We started, you know, live streaming the hostage situation as it unfolded. We started giving up updates, live updates.
I'll just interrupt you there because for those who don't know, there were no guidelines, no official guidelines on media coverage of terror or hostage attacks until that attack happened.
Yeah, so
in fact, the News Broadcaster Standards Authority was set up after these attacks, yes, precisely because of the criticism that came on the media coverage, and standards were then put in place. Now, whether those are adhered to by various networks is a totally different debate, but there were no standards at all before that.
Yeah.
And those standards were then at least put in place.
Right. Yeah, so while the attacks unfolded, you had the terrorists, the controllers looking at Indian television feeds and telling the terrorists what to do, where to get the hostages from. It was really appalling what happened. Now, I've put that in my book, right? Just the way it unfolded and what I was told there, that media coverage of the 26/11 attacks led to the direct deaths of 17 people in the Taj Hotel. You know, because they were told where the hostages were, the terrorists came and they killed them right there. It could have been far worse had there not been an instant response from the commandos. They arrived just in the nick of time to save the day. But having said that, I haven't written the screenplay for the series, so I really don't know. But I have a sense of how it's been addressed. The series is not out yet. But how they've addressed this issue is by inserting journalists. I mean, these are fictional characters who go through the dilemmas that you mentioned. You know, the fact that they have unwittingly led to the deaths of hostages there. And some of them are actually doing it consciously for TRPs. There's this intense television competition. I mean, you know what it was in 2008. Television was very young and new, and it was, you know, fiercely competitive. So that angle has been addressed there for the first time. I think that's really significant.
You know, one of the issues, I mean, we can all talk about this new golden age of storytelling, kind of like how it was in the US in the 50s, or even in Indian television at the beginning of the 90s, when satellite television first opened up, and now the digital platforms are opening that up again. But at the same time, isn't there a danger of over-exaggerating this, in the sense that you could argue, if you see the glass half full, that yeah, okay, lots of new kinds of programming is now being produced, but it's all too much of the same thing, too much more of the same thing, in the sense that are we really pushing the envelope, or is pushing the envelope only about the only difference being that you can utter more profanities on this platform as opposed to television or on film? Are we making fundamentally different kinds of stories, or are we just changing the form a little bit by showing a bit more naked flesh and by adding a few more expletives to the screen dialogue?
I completely agree with you. I think I fundamentally have a problem with how the representation of youth is on the OTT platform, because OTT, or the name itself, over the top, does not mean literally you go over the top in your representation, right? I mean, the youth are either misplaced or they're just having meaningless sex and they have bad relationships, they don't like their families. I mean, the youth are responsible a lot. Yeah. I speak...
Which may well be perfectly the way to live for a lot of people.
Yeah,
but you're saying that that's essentializing it for everybody.
Yeah, and my problem is you have to understand you're also knowingly or unknowingly influencing a lot of gullible minds. You have to understand that with the whole internet revolution, the percolation in tier 2 and tier 3 right now is massive. And you don't have to stereotype, like, especially when it comes to representation of marginal characters, in the sense if it comes to how the LGBT community is represented, or how always the cool, the stud boy of the college is supposed to be, or the trope of a small town girl who comes to a big city. The idea is to break away from the cliche. My problem is people in the head think they're doing it, but they're still playing around the same tropes. So you really need to, and it boils down to personally, you have to understand that the people who are on the other side of the table at the platforms still come from that bent of television and film.
It's the same lot of people.
It's the same
lot
of people.
That's the point I want to make, that, you know, with the internet, for example, for a very long time, the internet was, you know, the idea was the internet was synonymous with democracy, with freedom and all of that, with the profusion of a million voices and all of that. Increasingly, we are seeing on the internet, because of the business models, increasingly it's scale that works on the internet, right? And that has a huge impact on content, because the business models are intrinsically linked to the kind of content you produce. So increasingly, apart from individuals, when you're a company producing content, increasingly its internet is turning into a winner-take-it-all platform. Yeah. So my concern is that, is it the same for the OTT platforms as well? the same thing that we're seeing with Google, Facebook, the same you know, the issues of scale. So the point being that you end up playing the same TRP game on this, except that there are no TRPs, at least right. for worth their name on digital measurement. Yeah.
So I think it's that initial, it's that gold rush phase that we are seeing right now. And, you know, everyone's, you know, jumped into the race. They're making like millions of shows. And then I think this is all going to settle down after a few years. There are going to be a few left standing. When the dust settles, there'll be a very a few platforms that are left, and the rest would have all, you know, kind of vanished. So this is like that early phase of any thing, like the early phase of television, for instance, or the early phase of what was it? Airlines, budget airlines. There were so many of them that were launched, and ultimately there were only about three or four of them left standing. And I think similar thing is going to happen at OTT. It's only the guys who are going to be the deep pockets, the really big ones who are going to stay for the, you know, the long term.
And I must add at this, as someone who's constantly pitching to the web right now, it's already started. There are platforms that are already dying. So, right. And also we need to understand there is no metric for their success right now. It's all about perception. So there are shows, without naming the platform, where those shows haven't done well, because once you're in the industry, you know that. But it's always the perception comes from paid marketing on the internet, hoardings, and that just changes the game completely, because there are certain shows that come from deep pockets but haven't really gone. Because at the end of the day, the web is also about numbers. A lot of these platforms, like a Netflix, came in with the idea that India is a country which will give us numbers, but the content that they're producing, personally for me, hasn't worked in this country.
So, you know, are we still producing content? Okay, different content, slightly different content from what is happening on conventional television. By the way, most people I know don't watch television anymore. My family stopped watching television 2 or 3 years back, apart from when some really big event happens. And even if they watch television, they watch it only only by recording programs once in a while. Otherwise, everybody's on digital platforms. But digital is not measured yet, or not measured in any way that everybody accepts in a serious manner, in the way that you have measurement systems for conventional media. The question I want to ask is that, are we still producing content for what the entertainment industry or the larger media M&E industry thinks of as what the youth of this country is thinking? So their mind maps, which largely come from urban India and largely from metropolitan India, have we started even scratching the surface of tier 2, tier 3, and of rural India to do that kind of storytelling?
That is such a good question, because it is so true. Like, every time I'm in a meeting, the first question I ask from the person is, where are you from? As soon as they tell me they're from Bombay or South Delhi, that is when I know how do I navigate through this meeting. Because it is so true. People need to understand that there is a worldview beyond your worldview, and their perception of rural India is very different from what rural India is. Like, I was raised in Chandigarh, which is like the perfect blend of, say, a small town and a little bit of a metro city, because they like to ape it. I mean, yeah, go Punjabis, but that's different. My point basically is that they're not very clear of what the perception really is, and that is the biggest problem. Like, Netflix just came up with this series about a phishing scam that is done by a bunch of small town people. But if you see, the small town template has also now become a template. They'll all talk in a funny colloquial vernacular language. And it's almost like their Hindi has to be colloquially funny, otherwise it doesn't sell. And that's again setting a trope which is wrong fundamentally.
Sandeep, are we seeing sorry, you wanted to add to this?
No, I just want to add to what Sumrit said. He's absolutely right. We see the villages in a certain way, but the tier 2 and tier 3 are changing faster than we can think of. And there's that great story from Lagan, when Ashutosh Gowarikar was making Lagan. He issued an advertisement for people in the area of Kutch that he was shooting, that he said, please come and be the extras. You know, he wanted extras for the crowd sequence, and he called people there. And it's a period film, Lagan, set in the 19th century. And the villagers turned up in their jeans and sneakers and t-shirts. So they had to kind of postpone the shoot and get them ethnic wear, because in their minds, this film crew from Bombay thought that, oh, it's, you know, rural India, and they would probably be wearing, you know, dhotis and kurtas and, you know, hanging around the way they were 100 years back. So times are changing, and, you know, it's...
Are we seeing a revival of the war genre, of the spy genre in the Indian entertainment industry? Because, you know, there were a few war films in the... there was Hakikat in the 60s. There were a couple of films later, and then it just sort of petered out. now there's been Razi, there's been a whole bunch of web series on various digital platforms, and we are seeing a move towards a slightly more realistic portrayal of war and strife. Is that fair
absolutely.
Enough?
There's I call it the gold rush phase for war movies in India, because I think it was Uri that actually did it. Because for the first time, you actually saw a movie that was, well, not kind of over the top. It was almost quite factual. A lot of it was exaggerated, but it was brought in such a way that it kind of appealed to a very large number of people, and it was. The production standards were as good as anything that you would see in Hollywood. So that kind of sparked off this thing. And plus, there's a whole new audience that is very receptive to these kind of... these are the audiences that are brought up on 24 and they're watching, you know, Hollywood films now. And they want to say, where are our own stories? Where are the Indian war stories? Where are the Indian spy thriller stories? So you have... You know, biopics on Field Marshal Manekshaw being made. There's one very interesting project on R.N. Kao, the RNAW founder, that's coming up. Karan Johar is producing that. So there's a lot of interest in this genre, and I think this is that golden age has begun for war and thrillers.
Are we seeing this happening in regional languages with the same intensity or more intensity than what we are seeing in Hindi? Question to you.
Ideally, that should be the scenario, because also I personally feel that the OTT space hasn't really tapped the regional market as yet. Whereas, in fact, Z5 for that matter is one of the only platforms where I see a lot of regional content happening right now, and which is amazing. I mean, you have to understand that there are people, and it comes down to the whole debate of there are people who do not just speak Hindi and English in this country. And there are stories that need to be told according to sensibilities of the area that you come from. So it's super important for that to happen.
I'm thinking here of a film like Bahubali, which was multi-produced in multiple languages and released at the same time in those languages. And look at the numbers that it got and the response that a film like that got, Bahubali and Bahubali 2. And the biggest growth in the internet now is happening in the regional languages. For the last 2 years, all data that we've been looking at shows is the regional languages that are growing significantly. And along with the fact purchasing power is also rising in tier two and tier three towns in comparison.
I have to give you this personal anecdote. My cousins from a pind in Punjab, they've come down to my house, and their TikToks are booming. Like, it was unreal. Like, I'm talking about an 8-year-old who probably just knows how to navigate through the phone, basically has a TikTok account and it's booming. So the percolation it's real for sure.
Well, we should start taking questions from the audience. Anyone with questions? Any questions for the two gentlemen here? Okay, while we wait for questions, let me throw... Yes, ma'am.
Don't you think that, you know, Netflix in India is not working? Is it because of the stories they're putting, like ghost stories or something? Like, what's the reason? I mean, outside, I basically have a Netflix account, and I watch mostly American and Spanish shows. But I've never even watched a single Indian show. Can you explain the reason or something to the audience sitting over here?
You want to take that? I'll make one comment on this and then hand it over to both of them. You know, one of the main differences in Netflix in the American market versus Netflix in the Indian market from a business point of view is one of the reasons why Netflix did so well as a mass medium in the American market was it was much cheaper than what it cost to get a cable TV connection. So if you were paying, say, $100, I'm just giving a figure from the back of my head, you were paying about 1/10 of that for Netflix. In India, it is the other way around. In India, the Netflix is typically much more expensive than what you pay for cable TV. So, which is what it does. Then it becomes a more elite medium. Now you can, of course, the mass scale of this audience is far bigger. So you'll have enough people who will pay that, and that's already increasing. But that's a major fundamental difference between the American market and the Indian market. And that's to do with the fact of how cable television is also regulated in the United States and how it's regulated here.
Plus, I also think that it's a very niche kind of thing, right? Netflix hasn't managed to get the, for want of a better example, the Saas Bahu genre. They haven't got this big game-changing market. They're still focused in the small niches. So while Sacred Games is really popular and all, it's still being watched by a very small
number of
people.
See, one of the reasons for that, Sandeep, I think is, and it's not just Netflix. I mean, I think it's for all digital media OTT platforms. What's happening is that the people, the punts that are being made in producing shows, the punt is that increasingly we are now moving from a one television household to a multiple screen household. And when you are sitting in a one television household, the content you're producing is something which you think is the lowest common denominator for everybody in the family, which is where the Saas Bahu's genre came in. That look, from the mother-in-law to the housewife, in the stereotypical housewife, to the kids, everybody can watch this show. Now, everybody has the privacy of their screen, and they're watching what they're comfortable with individually. So when the OTT platforms are attacking that market, by force they're trying to, because their market is so targeted, they're saying, okay, let's make some alternative content, which is not available on the mainstream television screen.
Just adding to that, if you just look at the body of work that Netflix India has, it is primarily by the numero uno or the so-called top production houses, and the people who are involved in the production or the writing of the shows come from a certain segment of the country right now, in the sense like you'd have your Dharma Productions and you'd have like an Anurag Kashyap do it, or you'd have, you know, like, there aren't enough voices being represented and heard, because actually getting to Netflix for an independent writer or a producer or a director is still not easy. Because, and this I purely just say from, you know, experience, it's, yes, in theory you can totally do that, but you also have to understand, and like that also, because you have to, there are also, you have to have more voices to be heard. You have to let it become more democratic, in the sense that you let more stories come in. You meet people and you deal with people who are not just from a known fraternity. And it makes sense. I'm with them at that, because they've come to a country and these people are giving results, so they definitely go to them. So I think one of the reasons why personally I feel it's probably not worked is because they've played it safe, for the lack of a better word.
More questions? Yes.
Also, post we are done with Q&A, we can have the audio visuals being played for both of their pieces.
So actually, when we talk about the foreign market, we know like Christopher Nolan, Quentin Tarantino. But when we talk about Indian market, we only know about Shah Rukh, Aamir and Hrithik. So somewhere the directors, lyricists and the writers have been like underrated in Indian market of like all that. Like it feels unsafe, like when we go to the writing section, it's better to be an actor than a writer. That's the question. How, like, is there any change with the Netflix and all that coming up in the country?
I think, A, you need to, you're confusing an actor with a star.
Yes, the actually the actors get the stardom, but everyone
you're
else
talking
is
about. You're talking about the importance of the other of all the other creative people who work in producing a show like that.
Exactly.
And
everyone
the overemphasis
else is
on the
underrated.
Star. Fair enough. Good. You're
fair enough. And personally, it's an endeavor as a writer. Also, I make sure I'm out there, and I make sure I take the credit and get the credit for the work that I do. But you also have to understand, we are a country that is hysterical about two things. That is stardom, which, and actually just stardom or fame and popularity, and that percolates to cricket and Bollywood if you think of it, and they become the faces. You have to understand, they are the faces. But having said that, with the advent of internet and with all the OTT platforms coming in, all technicians, writers, directors, lyricists, cinematographers, and most importantly, editors. Like editors, personally, I didn't realize till the time I got into screenwriting that you can rewrite an entire script on the edit. And editors, you totally can do that, and editors aren't credited enough. So the idea basically is, I personally and strongly believe, to put your work out there and make sure that people know. But you have to understand that we are a country that is easily influenced by stardom. So yeah, it is a long journey, but take your baby steps and I think we'll get there.
Yes. Gentleman there in the middle of the room.
Could you throw some light on the revenue model, how this thing works? Is it like a one-time fee being paid by the OTT to own a program, or is it a royalty payment? And how do all the various people, the writers, directors, actors get Where is the money? What is the money flow trend?
Well, you have just the two people from different genres to answer that. So, Sandeep, you go first with that.
I sold my rights, so I didn't really have creative control over it. I was just a consultant on the project. But I got a fixed thing. But I imagine there would be other models as well where you have a percentage of the profits and stuff. I don't know. Sumit, probably you can...
So generally the process that happens is that the platform, a producer engages with the platform and you get a per episode budget. So the writer would get a writing fee, which could either be for the project as a lump sum or an episodic. And that again has three different avenues, which is story, screenplay and dialogue. You also probably, if you've developed a concept, which is your story bible, you can also get paid for that. So technicians are paid either per episode or for the project in lump sum. And the platform, I'm assuming, and I'm not very informed, the platform pays the producer per episode and it's based on the advertising, I'm assuming, that they get, because I'm not very informed on the platform's point of view. But when you auction a book, you sell the rights, basically. Like, I sold the rights, and since I was also screenwriting the project, I got money per episode for the story, screenplay, and dialogue. In fact, my producer is here in the audience, so, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
I just wanted to ask, now they were discussing that in India, Netflix has not taken off. So is there a reason behind this that society in India is still family-based? Western society is more individualistic. So maybe their preferences and choices over there dominate the kind of media or the entertainment they are choosing, while in India, TV may stay for a longer time because TV watching is a kind of celebration. And the second thing is, on the technology side, we are still lagging behind because if we have to go into the OTT platforms, we'll have to have data which is quality and quantity wise better. So are these reasons for behind the reason that Netflix or the other OTT platforms are not picking up as they should?
So Nalin should answer this.
So my immediate take on that is, first, I think sociologically speaking, the family versus the more individualistic thing, I think we shouldn't essentialize. I think there's a lot of evidence we're seeing in the last, in just on the streets in the last 2 months, how within the same family people have taken such different positions on political issues. I mean, if you look at the NRC protest, the CA protest, you will find a huge generational gap in some of these issues on the ground. In terms of, is there essentially a big difference? I think different societies have different cultural norms. So yeah, there could be some difference in that. But I don't think we should think just about a Netflix. It's not just about Netflix. It's just one example. There are many other platforms which are. He talked about TikTok. The point is that there is a massive profusion of content and multiple platforms. The issue, there is a difference between the mass consumption and who makes money from it. I think what's happened is people haven't cracked how to make money from it yet. And that's a larger problem with the digital platform right now. Apart from the big tech titans of Google and Facebook, making money on digital is a magic sauce that nobody has right now. And people for a long time have been aggregating audiences, thinking that, look, now we have the audiences and the money will come. But monetizing it is a challenge. And not just in India, that's a challenge globally. One answer to it is subscription. But because purchasing power in India is much lower compared to more developed markets, so that's a constant challenge. I would be a bit more optimistic on the future of digital storytelling than being negative on it. Yes, ma'am.
Can do justice to a book, a TV series or a movie?
Sorry.
What do you think can do justice to a book? I mean, a TV series or a movie? Because many times when you see it, especially Harry Potter, like the essence of the book was lost when it was adapted in a movie.
Should we just, there are two more questioners. Should we take three questions in a row and then we can take them together? The lady over there.
My question is, since you mentioned the film industry tends to be very incestuous in the way it works, and people go with people they know, and they go with people who are already famous. How did you as writers penetrate that kind of scenario and get your stories and scripts taken into a new medium like a web series?
And the lady over here as well. That's the third question we'll take. Yeah, right there.
Hello. My question is, in addition to the madam sitting in the front row, do you think branding plays an important role? And also, there are several OTT platforms, and when we compare all of them together, do you think an active collaboration between two or three platforms can uplift this market altogether?
Okay, you want to go with the Harry Potter question?
I think it is very subjective. There are certain, it all depends on the story. There are certain stories which can very well be told in the time frame of a movie. But then there are stories which require character development, and that is why the web is the perfect place to keep them over there, because there are stories where you fall in love with characters and they're plot-driven stories. So personally for me, it's a very subjective choice. Like, I love the Harry Potter movies as much as I love the books, so we can disagree on that. So yeah, it is subjective for me.
Yeah, I want to quickly add to that. I totally agree with Sumrit. It's very subjective. You know, there are cases of very, very engaging novels that have been made into great series and into short films. There's one called Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy. It's probably the greatest spy novel ever written. And that was filmed as a BBC series in the 80s with Alec Guinness. And more recently, as a feature film, as a 2.5-hour feature film. And it's an incredible work, because to compress a book as, you know, as diverse, as elaborate, so with the kind of characters and plots into a 2.5-hour thing, it's an incredible effort that's been done. So it's actually, again, it depends on the book that you're talking of. Lord of the Rings, for instance, could not have been done as one film. So the guy had to make three movies of it. And there are many other cases like that. There's one called The Spy that came out on Netflix very recently. That was based on a book written in the 60s called Our Man in Damascus. It's a very engaging novel. It would never have been made into a Hollywood film, because it was so, I mean, it like covered a 20-year thing in the story of Eli Cohen, you know? So it depends on the kind of characters and, you know, the plots and stories.
To the question on does it make sense for companies to join together, I mean, I think that was the question, right? I think the market often leads to various solutions like that. In the pre-digital age, you saw companies like Star and Z collaborating significantly on distribution platforms. You've just had News Corp selling its business to Disney. Rupert Murdoch selling those stakes off, precisely because. So you know, the point is, companies will survive separately as long as it's commercially viable for them to do it. But when it makes more commercial sense to team up and to create that economy of scale, more sense to do that than to be just be on your own, people will make those choices. And I think that's the whole nature of capitalism, that's the whole nature of the economy. We should let those market forces play.
There's a third question. The third question?
What
is it?
What, did we miss a question?
No. A supplementary question to...
What was the...
Like getting into this very incestuous film, you know, related writing market. How do you actually penetrate it when you have stories? How do you get to the Netflix level?
You want to take that question?
I really wish I had like a struggle story to tell where I like crossed rivers and, you know, like the parents didn't let me go and I had to run away from the house. I wrote my first book at 17. The book became a bestseller. And I was in college. I got a call from a production house in Bombay to write a youth show for them. I thought I'll come down for one semester, chill, make some money, and go back. But the show started doing really well. It just kept on leading to more work. And the work started getting popular. More books came in, and I reached, yeah. But having said all of that, I think it is still, if not the Netflix level, the idea is to start somewhere, and that is what I did. What happens is, a lot of the time, idealistically, we just keep on sitting on our chairs thinking that we just want to crack the topmost zone. But you can always start at a smaller platform. Like YouTube is the best example. Release your own content. You know, crowdsource, fund it through the crowd. or just put out your writing over there, and the internet watches now. If it's interesting, it will get picked up, and especially in the times where good things also get viral. So I think the most important aspect is to not, you know, look at the negatives, because the negatives will stay, but the idea is to just start somewhere and be patient about it.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
So we are all talking about the entertainment platforms, but what about the platforms that are only for writers, like web novel platforms? The writers there, many are there who are talented, but still not getting anything in return. What about whom?
Do you know Twilight and 50 Shades of Grey started on Wattpad? So actually, they were fan fiction theories which started on Wattpad, and eventually the books, you know, when to become the books that they are, no matter how good or bad they are. That's a separate story. I think I personally disagree with that question. Yeah, like I think those platforms, I mean, I love to read the fan theories on the shows that I've done or the books that I've written. And there are people who are scouting talent through that for sure. So just stay on that. In fact, Wattpad now has an active self-publishing unit also, where they engage with people who've, you know, written on their platform. So I completely disagree with that question, actually.
Right. On that note, we will have to wrap up this conversation. I'm told there are videos to play, so we'll just move to that. Please join me in thanking these two gentlemen, Sandeep and Sumrit, for a very interesting afternoon and an interesting conversation.
पर मजबूर कर दें अपने चारों तरफ जब लोगों को मरते हुए देखेंगे इनके हौसले अपने यहां भी खत्म हो जाएं
सिंक्रोनाइज 5 4 3 2 1 टाइम
जिन लोगों को हमारे मजहब पे यकीन नहीं है उनके लिए यह तरीक बहुत दर्दनाक होने वाली है बहुत दर्दनाक
हम लौटकर जरूर आएंगे अपना तिरंगा लहराकर या फिर उसमें लिपटकर
धीरे धीरे बढ़ने लगी जान कैसी है दोस्ती थोड़ा थोड़ा मैं तुझ सा तू
टाइनी यार पहली बार बेस्ट फ्रेंड गया तूने याद रखूंगा मैं
उसने अभी तक सेक्स भी नहीं किया
है शी इज वेटिंग फॉर अ स्पेशल टाइम
मिला हूं जब से तेरा हूं तब से पास तेरे हूं दूर सबसे
तुम दोनों हमेशा साथ साथ रहते हो ना
मां वो सिर्फ मेरा बेस्ट फ्रेंड है
वो भी सिर्फ बेस्ट फ्रेंड ही मानता है ना तेनू
लाइक नहीं लव करता हूं मैं तानी से बेस्ट फ्रेंड वाला
तू किसी भी चीज में कंसिस्टेंट नहीं है यार ना तेरा पैशन नॉट बीइंग अ गुड फ्रेंड
तुम्हारी यही तेरी प्रॉब्लम है अपनी लाइफ की सारी इनसिक्योरिटीज दूसरों पे थोप तू सर और मार बिकॉज यू डिजर्व
I would always remain his best friend.
जाने ना दूंगा कहीं
We wish to thank Sandeep Unnithan, Sumrit Shahi, and Nalin Mehta for this very interactive and enriching session. Audience, kindly note that the anarchy has been moved to 11:15 a.m. at the front lawn tomorrow. Do note that the authors will be available to sign their books at the book signing desk. It's right at the entrance of Charbagh. Also, please help us in keeping the venue clean by disposing any waste items in the waste bins located all across Diggy Palace. The next session at Charbagh is session 109, My Name is Y. We request the audience to kindly occupy the front rows first. We're doing this a matter now. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for you to win something. So one lucky member in the audience is sitting on the Zomato hot seat. Quickly check your backrest if you're the lucky one. Do we have a winner yet? Okay, so we have a winner. I see her making her way. All right, so she's won the Zomato goodie bag. Congratulations. Let's have a huge round of applause. Let's give her a huge round of applause. You could be the next one, so just